All right, guys, 11.5, the last section that we have in the book here. A couple of things to do with data and classifying and representing data, so different types of graphs and stuff like that. And then we'll get into misleading graphs at the end. First big thing here is a big important vocab thing here, the difference between qualitative and quantitative. If you think about the key words or I guess the root words here, for qualitative is quality, and quantitative is quantity. And quantity is a number. It's how many. So when we talk about quantitative data, we're talking about numbers that represent counts or measurements. Qualitative would be a quality that something has. So the fact that it's blue, or the fact that, we'll see some of these. I was going to say jersey numbers because it's down here, but that's going to take a little explaining. So they're going to ask you whether it's qualitative or quantitative, whether you're dealing with numbers, represent counts or measurements, or whether you're representing a label, okay? So prices of used cars at the dealership, of course, quantitative. That's a number, right? Jersey numbers are numbers, but they're labels, right? It wouldn't make much sense to take the mean of jersey numbers, or it wouldn't make much sense to find the range of jersey numbers. Because it's a label, it's not necessarily a measurement. So that's why B would be qualitative there. Song lengths would be quantitative, because that's a quantity, that's a measurement. And then zodiac signs, so Leo, Virgo, Gemini, all those would be qualitative there. So you're going to be asked to do some of those on the homework and on the test as well. Just make sure you know the difference between qualitative and quantitative. The next thing, choosing and creating a data display. There are lots of different ways to display data, and we see a bunch of them here. The main ones that we want to concentrate on would be bar graph. And bar graph is when we have specific categories that it's broken into, right? So this would be, what's your favorite color? Blue, red, green, other. That's a bar graph, right? A circle graph, okay? Circle graph is an important one. That's only when we have parts of a whole. That's when we have 100% of the data. So if we have 100% of the data, for sure 100%, we can use a circle graph to show how it's broken up. Bar graph and circle graph, sometimes you can use either, but if you don't have 100%, can't use that circle. Line graph. The line graph is change over time, so it has to deal with time. Okay, it's got to be over a period of months or years or days or seconds, something like that. Histogram, intervals of the same size. We've dealt with histograms before. Stem and leaf plot, we've seen on the homework here a little bit. Shows numerical data, shows how they are distributed. Just a small thing here. The numbers on the left are always the first digit. The numbers on the right are the second digit. So like this 0, since it's got a 1 there, that would represent 10. This 2 would be 12. And then 13. And then 16. And then we go on from there. 21, 21, 25, 39, and so on. So that's one way to represent. If you've got a lot of numbers that are pretty close, we can represent them that way. Box and whisker shows the variability. That's your five number summary that we talked about before. Dot plot is just how many times each value is occurring in a data set. And then scatter plot, we've talked about. The main things that we're going to look at here when you're choosing which ones to use would be your bar graph, your circle, your line, maybe a histogram, maybe a box and whisker, but typically it's those four that we're going to deal with most when you have to choose which one is the best way to represent. So eye color survey, number of students that had each color, that would be perfect for a bar graph, right? That'd be a bar graph. Circle graph would also work for that, but I'm not sure that this is all the students, right? So a bar graph would work just fine for that. Speeds of vehicles, you've got two different interstates here. Let's see, yeah, they did box and whisker. It just shows the the different ranges. It shows how spread out, how variable it is. That's probably going to be better than a bar graph, right? A bar graph, you're going to have a bunch of little lines. Histogram might work there as well, but the book decided to go with the box and whisker. The last thing in this section is misleading graphs. And a lot of times, guys, you're going to run into graphs where something's not right with it. And you see a bunch of things to look at here. If it's going to be a good graph, you need to be able to answer all of these things. It's got to have a title. It's got to have a key if it needs a key, right? If there's more than one line on it, we got to know which line represents what. We need a key. Are the numbers evenly spaced? Are the axes labeled? Does it begin at zero? Is there a break? We've looked at breaks before. Are they all the same size? The reason why these are important is because a lot of times people out there create graphs that are meant to deceive or mislead, right? That's where we get misleading graphs. They want you to think something else, okay? Think of something different. So it's not that they're lying to you. It's not that they're giving you wrong information. It's that they are representing it in a way that makes it look different than it actually is. Okay, it makes you think they're better in some way. So if we look at the two examples here, first one, right, you look at tuition, room, and board at all colleges and universities, we're seeing it go up big time. That's a huge, right? That's a big time jump. If you look at this, would be right here compared to this, it looks like it almost doubled to get up there over the course of 4 years. But if you look at the numbers, it's not necessarily the case. So to the untrained eye, one that hasn't gone through a good mathematics program, you might see that and say, oh, it's double. This is crazy. But in reality, we know it's not quite there. If I was going to make a good graph out of that, let's see, we got 08, 09, 10, and 11. I know I got to go all the way up to like 1850 or 18,500. Let's call it 20,000, okay, up at the top. This would be about 10,000. So that's 15,000 there. So if I'm gonna represent all of these with a bar graph, 08 is gonna be at about 16, 09 is gonna be at about 17, that's gonna be here, that's gonna be here, still not up to that 20,000. So yeah, when you look at it this way, it looks like, sure, it went up, but it didn't drastically go up, it went up a little bit. So they're making it seem like it's a bigger change than what it actually is. And that's a common key here. You're going to see that a bunch. On this one over to the right, we've got a break, so that's okay. You can start at zero and have a break. That's okay, right? If they had done that over here, then it would have been fine. If we had started at zero and said, all right, I'm breaking the graph, now I'm jumping up to 15,500. That would have been okay. Now over here, the problem is that it starts out counting by 0.02, 0.02, 0.02, 0.02, 0.02, and then it starts counting by 0.01. You can't do that, right? You gotta stay consistent. So what that would do, if we were going to shrink this down, that point would actually be like right here, and that point would be like right here. So it's gonna change what it looks like because they represent it in a different way, it changes the meaning. Now, I've got some that I've found over the years that we're going to look at real quick, and this is it. This is the last part, but I want to point out these real-life graphs that I've come across. First one, from this past year, Joe Burrow's draft stock. There is so much wrong with this graph. It looks like a linear graph. This is not linear, okay? First of all, look at the axes labels, okay? Look at the look at the numbers. You've got not ranked. 62, 15, 4, 2, and they're evenly spaced. How can you have even space between 62 and 15, and 15 and 4, and 4 and 2? There's, 2 in between there, there's 11 in between here, and there's a whole lot more in between here. You can't space it evenly that way. And same thing on the bottom. You went from September 1 to October 1 to November 1, that's great. But then November 15, only half a month, and then only 4 days later? You can't represent data like that. This graph is just not good. Probably an ESPN graph. We see a couple more of those moving forward, but it's just not good because it doesn't make sense there. The next one was actually up in the high school for a while. I don't know if it still is. And it's representing the ACT scores of Byron Center and Michigan. Think to yourself, why might this be misleading? Well, if you look, because of where the bars start, right? This bar starts here. This bar starts way down here. So yeah, it's true that we have a higher ACT average than the state. It's not as big of a difference as it looks on this graph. And, you know, it also doesn't start at zero, so we know that. But the fact that they are offset like this, and I know they used a computer program and this was one of the options and it looks cool and whatever, but it makes us look a whole lot better maybe than we actually are because of that difference here, right? If they started at the same level, you'd figure that the gray one would actually be up here instead of down here. So just a different way of looking at it. You got to be aware of these things when you're seeing them. This next one just was one in the news that I came across, and just ignoring what it's talking about, just look at the graph itself. I mean, what do you notice about the graph itself? That graph itself is just not good. How can you have a circle graph with 51, 43, and 34? That doesn't make sense. And you're not talking about parts of a whole. You're talking about three different poles, today, last year, and 1997. You can't combine those into one circle graph. That doesn't make any sense. And then the last one, this is my all-time favorite, ERA by inning, first inning and after. No numbers at all, just nothing. You can't, if there's no numbers here, you can't tell. This could be, you know, 2-1. This could be 17-4. Like, who knows without numbers there, which this was one that they had tweeted out years ago. And I don't know if there were just other math teachers that were looking at it or just other people in general that, you know, pay attention to these things. But they just, on Twitter, they got pretty beat up over it because people were seeing it and trying to figure out what it was talking about. But anyway, misleading graphs, that's what we're looking at. You'll see some questions about those. That's it for 11.5, the last section of the book. Congratulations, you made it. Now you just got to do the homework.